Dear Minister Joanna, ladies and gentlemen, distinguished audience, I am honored to be listened to by such a high-level audience as the audience of today. The Aspen Institute of Romania is an excellent venue for debates and an incubator for open and new ideas. I'm always leaving after the meetings of the Aspen Institute richer than the moment I arrived in the room. I'm also impressed that you have proved to be resilient enough to sacrifice Saturday morning in order to be together with us and to listen to me and to other speakers in the room. I do not know how and when the moment Minister Joanna decided about the date of this meeting. I can't give you an answer, but I will tell you very honestly that it was an incredibly timely moment for organizing it. On the 7th of June, two important EU documents came out. The joint communication on the strategic approach to resilience, very valid for our discussions today, and the 4 out of 5 reflection papers by the Commission tied to the future of Europe subject, namely the paper on the future of European security and defense. And on the 25th of May, we had the NATO summit, and yesterday, our president, as you already said, met the US president, where certainly NATO was one of the main subjects of the discussions. Dear guests, distinguished colleagues and friends, the efforts over the last 2 decades to conceive new model of security cooperation at the scale of the entire European continent and beyond have been successful to a certain degree. Nevertheless, they have been largely undermined, and I'm sorry to underline it myself, especially in our region, Eastern Flank, the Baltic and the Black Sea, by accelerating events since 2008. This and blatantly the 214 Crimea aggression and conflict in eastern Ukraine signaled the resurgence of conflicts in the Black Sea region and the eastern neighborhood, with deepening demarcation lines, increasing militarization, growing trafficking, and insecurity of all types, negatively affecting the security of the entire European continent. Under such circumstances, we have learned that coordinated action is needed more than ever, so that the Euro-Atlantic community strengthens its own security and resilience, while also increasing that of the eastern and southern neighbors. Romania believes that NATO's presence must be under such circumstances solid, based on a long-term vision and fully integrated with other relevant allied efforts, so as to strengthen deterrence and defense actions in the entire European flank. Romania, as you know, there is no need to insist on this, it's a deeply committed NATO member. That explains why we are one of the first members to take part in the program UIA NATO, a public diplomacy program. And I want to acknowledge and to express my gratitude for the support of NATO Public Diplomacy Division for today's event as well. We need to better explain NATO to our citizens, but it is also paramount to actively support partners like the Republic of Moldova, Ukraine or Georgia, especially in helping them to develop national defense capabilities so as to prevent a worsening of regional security. The Western Balkans is another area where we have to act more decisively. To turn the efforts already made into long-term successes. This way, we can also prevent other actors from taking advantage of the vulnerabilities in the region, of unsolved problems in the region, with the objective of challenging the EU and NATO, stabilizing influence. The recent NATO-Brussels summit and the celebration of the 60th anniversary of the signing of the Treaty of Rome took place against a general transformative background, among which, not least, some historical developments in the security and defense of the Euro, at the European Union level. Of course, NATO continues to play a key role in the current security context. It remains the guarantor of the collective defense of its members and also an important player in projecting stability beyond the Allied borders. If a few days ago there were discussions about this commitment of the United States to be a guarantor for the members of the alliance, after the visit of the President of Romania, on the occasion of the visit of the President of Romania, it was a very clear statement about the cornerstone represented by Article 5 and the commitments of the United States. The recent high-level meeting in Brussels confirmed the determination of all the members of the alliance to respond to threats and challenges coming both from East and from the South, thus addressing security concerns of all members. There is also a common understanding of the fact that such an ambitious agenda requires also proper investments by all and a fairer burden sharing. You all know that Romania has become one of the positive examples again by deciding to allocate the 2% of the GDP for defense. I want to take this opportunity to express again my appreciation for our leadership and our entire political scene for having agreed to a national consensus around that allocation. It is crucial in itself, it's very important for Romania and for NATO, but I think it should be also used as a good experience for other subjects of national interest in our country. The EU global strategy has, in its turn, created a framework for adapting the changing our procedures and instruments for EU's external actions. The aim is to ensure more unity, coherence, and relevance. Indeed, a view, vision, and a new level of ambitions is emerging for the EU as a whole. The relationship between the EU and NATO has entered a new phase itself, adapting to new realities, being creative and flexible, is fundamental in an important and constantly changing environment. Excellent relations with NATO support the achievements of the EU and vice versa. A clear expression of where we are and what we can do together can be seen in the list of the 42 common actions implementing the joint EU-NATO declarations adopted at the summit of NATO in Warsaw. Both NATO and EU tackle resilience, yet from different angles. Close coordination and harmonizing of instruments from this point of view is vital. A few words about resilience now. Coming closer to today's very attractive conference title, a few words about enhancing resilience across the Alliance. Resilience is a precondition for a successful collective defense. It is also ensuring continuity. About successfully sustaining pressures or responding to shocks, it implies a whole of the government approach and appropriate civilian support to military forces when faced with various types of threats. If earlier our governments were concentrated on protecting territory, this was the main objective. Now, today, we are more preoccupied to prepare ourselves to protect our connectedness. We live in open societies, but the channels that sustain openness are easily to be used as a means of disruption. The recent cyber attacks which took place in Europe are a very clear proof of this assertion. Our openness is our great asset, but it is also our great vulnerability. To project it implies a serious security challenge that we have to meet appropriately by anticipating, preparing for, and addressing vulnerabilities, plan for the worst, and hope for the best. Therefore, baseline resilience requirements in NATO member states are all the more important. Seven areas which were identified by NATO apply to the entire crisis spectrum, and NATO is an organization, is ready as an organization to support its members to make progress in all these areas. For collective defense to be efficiency, civilian preparedness is once again a must. Building resilience involves many stakeholders. NATO needs resilient partners to reinforce its own resilience as an organization. It is our own interest to help more vulnerable societies to become more resilient by projecting resilience forward. Possible instruments for NATO: the assistance package to support Ukraine, Georgia, and the Republic of Moldova under the Defense Capacity Building Initiative should be developed in the future and encompass resilience. NATO expertise can help partners improve their own capacity for assessing and improving resilience. Fields like cyber defense and civil emergency planning are increasingly featuring in defense capability building packages for partners such as Georgia and the Republic of Moldova. The energy dimension is also in need for a more structured public framework, policy framework, sorry, and practical instruments to address major vulnerabilities to view of the broader implications of energy resilience at the state, economy, society, household, and including individual families. The disruptive character of disinformation campaigns and propaganda makes it critically important for us to enhance also the effectiveness of strategic communication instruments of the EU and of NATO, and to transfer acquired expertise to our partners. Civil preparedness could also aim at forging psychological resilience of our citizens against the manipulations of different sorts. Also, importantly, to use the knowledge and experience of frontline countries for lessons learned, sharing with other states and actors while developing media strategies within relevant governments, agencies to counter disinformation. NATO, of course, has made important progress in all these fields. But the European Union has done some important work as well. The EU global strategy identifies state and societal resilience as one of the five priorities of the EU external action. The recently published EU joint communication on resilience marks an important progress in carrying out the implementation of this strategy. It is an ambitious and far-reaching initiative to which we, from the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, have provided some valuable input by organizing in Bucharest a seminar with the European Union support dedicated to resilience as seen from the Black Sea perspective. Translating ideas and principles into reality is, of course, no easy job. It does not end with the communication, how important it could be. Quite the contrary, work only begins with the adoption of this communication. This is one of the reasons why we gladly accepted the Aspen Institute invitation to speak about this topic. Resilience becomes a fundamental concept for political decisions and concrete measures. From now on, it will be one of the basic problems of our countries. It is a common threat for initiatives, a threat for initiatives aimed at increasing stability, security, sustainable growth, functional institutions, as well as a means of deepened relations with partners. Resilience has become important in terms of EU policy and decision making across numerous thematic and regional discussions. Building on what has been already achieved in the field, Romania welcomes the communication, the strategic approach of this communication to resilience. The ambition is to further mainstream it to incorporate resilience horizontally in the EU policies. As part of this much needed common and comprehensive understanding, we pay particular attention to a two-field approach. Resilience as a political concept needs to remain value infused and also to be declined into practical and operational dimensions. These two combined can effectively sustain the EU soft transformation power with today's value-disturbed world. Ensuring the security of our citizens is one of our most important objectives. Therefore, at this European Union level, and more emphasis we consider should be attached to this concept. In light of the above, resilience of the EU's strategic neighboring countries should further represent an autonomous trend of work, especially countering the vulnerabilities and fragility in Romania's direct vicinity. A structural approach with emphasis on situational awareness, preventions, and early action requires adapting our views and our instruments to the new challenges. We will all agree that strengthening resilience is not a process with a clear beginning or with a clear end. It is rather a continuous process of improving our capacity to manage change and to overcome pressures and crises. Change, pressures, and crises are daily bread on our table, resilience becomes, I will conclude by this, our individual and collective task, as well as a moral imperative. Thank you.